not been able to return. And so therefore, you are stuck with me, and my name is Clem Kadiddlehopper. Some of you younger people have no idea who Clem Kadiddlehopper was. And Susan, all the way from Tucson, you came up to worship. So God bless you. Good to see you. Let us unite our hearts in the prayer of the day. Almighty and ever-living God, increase in us your gift of faith, that forsaking what lies behind and reaching out to what lies ahead, we may follow the way of your commandments and receive the crown of our joy. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Please be seated. We will now have the children's message.
Or you message.
Pleasant vineyards, you shall not drink their wine. hate evil and love good, and establish justice in the hateful. And may it be that the Lord, the God of hosts, will be gracious to the remnant and chosen. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from Psalm 90. We'll read it responsibly by verse. So teach us to number our days, that we may apply our hearts to wisdom.
Return, O Lord, how long do you tarry? Be gracious to your servants.
Satisfy us by your steadfast love in the morning. So shall we rejoice and be glad all our days.
Make us glad as many days as you afflicted us, and as many years as we suffered adversity.
Show your servants your work, and your splendor to their children.
May the graciousness of the Lord our God be upon us. Prosper the work of our hands. Prosper our handiwork.
A reading from the letter to the Hebrews, the fourth chapter. Indeed, the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing into mind, soul, spirit, joints, and marrow. It is able to judge the thoughts and intentions of the heart. And before him no creature is hidden, but all are naked and laid bare to the eyes of the one to whom we must render an account. Since then, we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold fast to our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who, in every respect, has been tested as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore approach the throne of grace with boldness, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Word of God, word of God.
Thanks be to God. It is right that you are able for the reading of the Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the 10th chapter.
Glory to you, Lord.
As Jesus was setting out on a journey, a man ran in and knelt before him and asked him, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Jesus said to him, "Why do you call me good? No one is good but God alone. You know the commandments. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness. You shall not defraud. Honor your father and mother." He said to him, "Teacher, I have kept all these things since my youth." Jesus, looking at him, loved him and said, "You lack one thing. Go, sell what you own and give the money to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come, follow me." When he heard this, he was shocked and went away grieving, for he had many possessions. Then Jesus looked around and said to his disciples, "How hard it will be for those who have wealth to enter the kingdom of God." And the disciples were perplexed at these words. But Jesus said to them again, "Children, how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of God." They were greatly astounded and said to one another, "Then who can be saved?" Jesus looked at them and said, "For mortals it is impossible, but for God, for all God things are possible." Peter began to say to him, Lord, we have left everything and followed you. Jesus said, truly I tell you, there is no one who has left house or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or fields for my sake and for the sake of the good news, who will not receive a hundredfold now in this age, houses, brothers and sisters, mothers and children in fields, with persecutions, and in the age to come, eternal life. But many who are first will be last, and the last will be first. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. Interesting day, isn't it, to get together? Hello. It's a beautiful day in the neighborhood, right?
Yes.
In preparation for the day's message, and I was told by one of our dedicated members to keep it short, I'm not going to mention his name, but you know who you are because you're sitting here. But I'm going to focus on a unique chapter in the Bible for a few minutes. Set your time, and I'll guarantee you one thing, I will not go beyond the time you set. There's a story in the Bible of 42 chapters. It is the story of the struggles of Job. You remember Job? Now let's go back and look at a few verses in that chapter. 42 chapters. First of all, it tells us that Job was a very upright man. He was a man who was faithful, a man who was blessed, a man who had a great deal of fortune, had had a great deal of wealth, and was respected the world over in his area for being one of the finest people on the face of the earth. Regularly, he offered burnt offerings and thanksgiving to God for his many blessings. And then the devil came, and the devil said to God, you know what, let me tell you something about this Job fellow. You have given him everything, but in reality, if he is tested, he will forsake his faith in you, and he will turn around from you and walk away. But what did God say? He said, try it. Let's see. So guess what happened? Here's what the Bible says. His oxen, that is Job. His oxen were plowing, and the donkeys were feeding beside him, and they fell upon them and carried them off and killed the servants with the edge of the sword. All his sheep were burned up, and all those who were watching Job's sheep were destroyed. And while he was still speaking, another one came to him and said, your sons, now get this, your sons and your daughters were eating and drinking wine in their elder brother's house, and suddenly a great wind came across the desert, struck the four corners of the house, and it fell on the young people, and they are all dead. I alone have escaped to tell you this. And what did Job say? The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. And all this, Job did not sin or charge God with wrongdoing. Now, there are many of you who are struggling with what has happened to us recently. In fact, I'm wearing the clothes that basically is all I have for a few other shirts. Everything else is being washed by friends, members of the church. They're in the cleaners, and the cleaners is closed, so I couldn't get my sport coat out to her today. Hello. That's nothing compared to what happened to Job. Thousands of people, 2.1 million of people, were without power and electricity because of what nature has done. All of this, I'm not saying it's comparable to what happened to Job, but it comes close. It comes close. We're being tested. Always being tested when crises come in our lives. If you direct your heart heartily. You will stretch out your needs before Him. And the man said to Job, why don't you just walk away from God? You are a righteous man, but obviously you have done something wrong, or else you would not be so punished. But Job would not listen to them. Job remained faithful to God for the blessings he had received. Again, the scripture says this, to his friends who were advising him how to behave so he might retain his health. Remember how bad his health was? The scripture says he was taking pottage, portions, that is, clay pot pieces, scratching because the sores were itching him. And he was feeling great pain and discomfort. All of his friends and all of his families were gone, and no one was there to comfort him. Just the opposite here at St. Paul Church. Friends came out of the woodwork to help my wife and me when our home was flooded. Friends in the church, neighbors, our daughter and her husband brought friends from up in another part of Lakewood Ranch in order to help. We even had a congressman. I shouldn't mention his name, I'm going to. We had a congressman, representative from this area, Stubby, came and spent a couple hours at our house cleaning the mess up. All of these things was the opposite of what these friends were doing for Job. They were pushing him to the ground, trying to get him to deny his relationship and his faith with God. And this is what Job says. As for you, you whitewash with lies, and all of you are worthless physicians. All of you are worthless physicians. Think about that. Think about that. He was certain of his faith in God, and he would not give in. And then he says this, I laid my strength into dust. My face is red with weeping, and deep darkness is on my eyelids. Though there are no violence in my hands, or my prayer is pure, on earth do not cover my blood, that my cry find no resting place. Even now, in fact, my witness is in heaven, says Job. Even now, my witness is in heaven. And he that vouches for me is on high. God will reside with me. There it is. And he says this again, Job, that is, I have kept his way. I have been faithful to God and have not turned aside. I have not departed from the commandment of his lips. I have treasured in my bosom the words of his mouth. Steadfast to the end was Job. 2.1 million people are still without power. The floods came, the surge came, the winds came. I don't know where you were on Wednesday evening when Milton decided to visit, following the lead with all of its damage. Did you have any fear? Were you concerned about your well-being? Were you concerned about others? When you could not reach him by phone or with texting, were you concerned? Yes, you were, if you were being honest. I know that we were, and yet we had faith. We truly believed that God would prevail, as Job did. And here we are today, in a beautiful day, together, praising the Lord. Job again took up his discourse and said to his friends, as God lives, who has taken away my mite, and the Almighty who has made my soul bitter, as long as there is breath in me, and and the Spirit of God is in my nostrils, my lips will not speak falsehood, and my tongue will not utter deceit. Far be it from me to say that you are right, he says, until I die, I will not put away my integrity with me. I hold fast in my righteousness before God. And he continues for some time, and you know the end of the story. God, and there's a few chapters at the very end, that God just reminds Job that he's in charge. In spite of everything he has, in spite of all the loss, he's in charge. He tells Job of how he has created everything. And you know what Job says? You know, Lord, I did not know all of these things. But I do know this, I repent of anything I have done wrong. And I've seen your love and forgiveness. And what happened? He has restored manyfold. Many of us who have suffered have lost a lot of earthly treasures. Some of the things, when they towed away my 66 Mustang convertible, that was one of the ultimate losses. When they took away some of those antique furniture that we had in our living room that are heritage of our family, guess what? They're things. They meant something to us. But God promised that he would be with us as he would with each and every one of you. Never deny your faith. Let not the issues of the world confuse you about God's love, because he is always with us. I'll probably never have another 66 Mustang convertible. But guess what? That's okay. It's okay. I still have my wife. I still have my family. I still have my friends. I still have God's love. As with Job, I and millions of others will have that which God has promised, a place in heaven for us, strength to get through tomorrow, in the next day. Amen. If you will, please do the hymn of the day, Seek Ye First, and we will sing all three verses. Seek Ye First, hymn of the day, Seek Ye First. Thank you. uncertainty and distress. Hurricane Milton has left many unable to gather in your house, and we feel the weight of separation and loss. Yet we know that no storm, no force of nature can separate us from your love. Surround us with your peace and comfort. Fill our homes with your presence. Remind us that the church is not just a building, but a people, united by your saint, your spirit. In our separation, may we be drawn. Lord, we pray for those who are still in harm's way, and for those who have lost homes or loved ones. Be their shelter and refuge. Protect those working in rescue and relief efforts, and strengthen those who are rebuilding. Give us courage and open to our eyes to see how we can serve others during this time. Let us pause now and offer our private prayers. I hear privately or out loud as I pray again for my personally, for those who have helped here at St. Paul, for the restoration of our area, our building, our campus, for those who came to our homes and homes of others, my daughter and her families, my son and his friends, and others, O God. We pray for those who were relief efforts in the fire department, the police department, and others, O God. We also pray for the military throughout this world. We come ask your blessing for them. All of these things, O Lord, we ask in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Let us now extend the sign of the peace to one another. This is the peace that we offer in God's love. Amen. Or in the sanctuary, they're there for you if you forgot to put an offering in the offering plate. And if you are listening or observing the service, following the service, you can go online to make a gift to support the ministry of St. Paul Lutheran Church. For those who are not with us but are watching at home, we offer our special prayers to you. May you be comforted with a safe environment where you reside. May your health be improved. May you know that we love you as we certainly feel your love for us. My Jesus, I believe that you are present in this most blessed sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot now receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there, and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and our praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of our everlasting life. And so with the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the host of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. So now, if you would just merely lift this up and then and peel off the top part. Consume the bread as contained. Take and eat. This is the body of Christ given for you. In the same manner also, consume the wine or the grape juice. This is the blood of Christ shed for you. Take and drink. Take and eat. Now for those who wish to come to the altar, you may do so at this time following the instructions of the ushers.
Thank you.
may the God and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace, now and forever.
Amen.
Let us pray. Holy God, who have welcomed us to this meal and fed us with dignity at your table, send us now to welcome others and to be at peace with one another through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
God Almighty, God most merciful, may he bless you, keep you, and give you peace.
Amen.
Our closing hymn, sending him.